Hello, Tech World, this is TechThoughts, and welcome to this special TechThoughts video series focused on learning PowerShell. This is an operationally designed video series that aims to get you ramped up and using PowerShell quickly. This is video 3 in the series, State of the Shell. As always, if you prefer written documentation, the corresponding article for this topic can be found on the techthoughts.info blog, which I've linked in the description below. Let's go ahead and get started. It can be really beneficial to have a pulse on the current state of PowerShell. What's going on with PowerShell today, and where is PowerShell headed tomorrow? Let's cover some quick PowerShell history and then dive into the state of PowerShell. PowerShell was created by Jeffrey Snover. He's a fantastic guy, and if you ever get an opportunity to go see him speak in person, he's a great presenter and is always sharing a lot of great information. You can also follow him on Twitter at jsnover. And back in 2002, he created PowerShell with a proposal of the Monad Manifesto, which is a really fantastic document. This document proposed the original design of PowerShell. Now, while this isn't required reading for you to understand PowerShell, it still remains a really fascinating document that provides a lot of insight into the early design decisions. So I highly recommend that you check it out. In the earlier days, PowerShell was released as part of the Windows operating system. And as we progressed through PowerShell 1, PowerShell 2, 3, and 4, these were typically tied to a Windows release. So Windows XP would get a version, Windows 7 would get a version, Server 2008, Server 2012, all of these would release with a new version of PowerShell. And these different versions would have different commandlets, different functionalities, and various improvements. As each version came out, PowerShell just continued to get better. Again, this was Windows only. You can check out the techthoughts.info blog, which contains additional information about the different versions of PowerShell. If you're not sure what version of PowerShell that you're currently running, either on your workstation or in your environment, you can open up a console window and you can type in PSVersionTable. What I'm doing here is I'm typing in PSVER, and I'm using IntelliSense and Tab to complete that for me. PSVersionTable is a reserved variable that gives you a lot of version information about the current version of PowerShell that you're running. So we can see here specifically on the PS edition that we're running the desktop version, and the PS version that we're running is PowerShell 5.1. It also includes a little bit of build information. You'll notice over here that if I run the same command, PSVersionTable, that this version is running PowerShell 7. And the PS edition is core, which we'll get to in more detail in just a moment. PowerShell was originally a Windows-only shell and progressed through versions 1 to 5.1, which we see annotated here. Understanding what version that you're running inside of your environment is very important because the capabilities that are in 5.1 may be very different than the capabilities that are in PowerShell version 4, for example, or PowerShell version 3. Again, consult the techthoughts.info blog for more information, but as a general rule, you can generally consider that a higher version has additional capabilities with a few exceptions, which we'll get into now. So the release of PowerShell version 6 was a huge departure from the 5.1 version. I'm going to cover a couple of specifics because the release of PowerShell version 6 caused a lot of confusion in the community, and it's very important that you understand the difference between higher versions of PowerShell and PowerShell 5.1. The first thing is that PowerShell 6 saw the release of PowerShell becoming open source. What does that mean? Well, that means that Microsoft has published PowerShell to GitHub. So you can come on GitHub onto the PowerShell repository and see the entire code base of PowerShell. Not only that, but you can come over to the Issues tab and open up bugs that you think that PowerShell may have, or see if someone else has already reported a bug that's going on inside PowerShell. And the PowerShell team will help address this. If you happen to know how to code in C#, you can also contribute to some of these errors and make PowerShell better. In addition to becoming open source, PowerShell also became cross-platform, and we got PowerShell version 6 on Linux and macOS. So you can see here that I am running Ubuntu, and we have PowerShell running inside of this Linux operating system. It really can't be understated how much of a big deal this is, because now you're empowered to learn one particular shell language, which can make you very effective on multiple operating systems. So if you know how to check for processes in Windows using git process, you also know how to check for processes over in Linux. This is hugely empowering for you and your career, and this makes PowerShell a very attractive language to learn. Okay, but there are a couple of confusing points between PowerShell version 5.1 and higher versions of PowerShell. So you would normally think that as you transition to a higher version number, that you'd get a lot more capabilities. That's not actually the case between PowerShell version 5.1 and 6, so let me discuss some of the specifics. With PowerShell 6, the PowerShell team was able to achieve cross-platform by transitioning to .NET Core. That's the core that you see here. Notice also that if I type in PSVersionTable in Linux, that it is also running Core. But at the time, .NET Core did not have the same level of coverage as previous PowerShell versions. So PowerShell 6 on release actually had less functionality than PowerShell 5.1. This wasn't an issue for Linux and Mac OS users, as they weren't previously able to engage PowerShell at all. But PowerShell 6 saw very slow adoption in the Windows world because 5.1 provided a better experience in many aspects. .NET Core has come a long way since then, and with the release of PowerShell 7, the PowerShell team has settled into a groove that fully realizes cross-platform support. Linux and Mac OS users, you're going to be using PowerShell 6 or a higher version moving forward. If you're on the Windows side, you can have the best of both worlds. You can run PowerShell 5.1 and higher versions of PowerShell side by side, as you can see I'm running here. Let's talk about how this is possible. Windows PowerShell uses the PowerShell.exe, which is located here under System32. PowerShell uses the PWSH.exe found under Program Files. Because we're running different executables, we can run these different versions of PowerShell side by side. You may be thinking to yourself, well, I'll just stick with 5.1 since it's included natively with the operating system. But I'm going to make the case that you go ahead and transition over to a higher version. 7 has many performance improvements, and in many cases, you can accomplish tasks at 8 times the speed of 5.1. Additionally, it has many refactored elements, including parallel support, new operators, refactored invoke web request and invoke rest method, better error investigation, and much more. So let's quickly recap. If you're running on Linux, you're going to be running a PowerShell version higher than 6, full stop. You don't have to worry about any previous edition of PowerShell. If you're running on Windows, you're going to be running in your environment something like PowerShell 2 to PowerShell 5.1, most likely. Hopefully 5.1, as that has the latest of the available stuff from a Windows perspective. If you're not sure, again, run PSVersionTable. You'll see that you're most likely running PowerShell 5.1. But again, you can run both versions side by side. Remember that 5.1 is regulated to security updates only moving forward. All of the new goodness is going to come in higher versions of PowerShell. So what else is going on with PowerShell today? Well, it's available on nearly everything. We've shown that it's available on Linux, it's available on Windows, but not only is it cross-platform, it's cross-cloud as well. So whether you're on a private cloud or public cloud, there are PowerShell modules that offer capabilities across a wide array of platforms. Speaking of modules, the PowerShell Gallery has nearly 10,000 published modules, which can help you solve diverse problems across a broad range of tech. So, where is PowerShell headed tomorrow? PowerShell is currently being managed by Principal Software Engineer Steve Lee at Microsoft. I highly recommend that you follow him on Twitter for the latest updates on what's going on with PowerShell. He releases a yearly blog post that lays out what the PowerShell team will be focused on in the coming year. You can see here that new versions are on the horizon with an ever-increasing set of new capabilities and features. A great way to stay current with what PowerShell can do is to plug into the PowerShell ecosystem. You can, of course, follow Jeffrey Snover and Steve Lee on Twitter, subscribe to the PowerShell blog, which I have linked here, stop over to Reddit on reddit.com/r/PowerShell and see what's going on with people and what they're using PowerShell for today. Also, consider joining the PowerShell conversation on the PowerShell Discord. I hope this video has given you some context on the state of PowerShell. It really is a powerful language that's doing a lot in today's current technology landscape, and it's really primed to help us continue solving technical problems across a diverse technical stack in the future. If you'd like to learn more about PowerShell's history, I highly recommend picking up Shell of an Idea by Don Jones. It's a fantastic read that dives into the complete history of how PowerShell was created. You'll find a link in the description below. Don't forget that all of this information is available in written format on the techthoughts.info blog. And if you found this video helpful, go ahead and click that like button and subscribe for more Tech Thoughts videos.